most of you know the history of these homes, two of them, built by Franklin's mother, Sarah, and one house given then to Eleanor and Franklin as a wedding gift, but then mother put them together, and so they all lived here happily, so to speak, and perhaps I gave Eleanor an incentive to become involved in Hunter College. And when Mrs. Roosevelt died in 41, Franklin and Eleanor then had a better place to live, and they wanted Hunter very much to have this. And under the leadership of Jennifer Rabb, our current president, this house was restored after years of neglect and made a public policy institute. In addition to the undergraduate programs, think of it as a kind of undergraduate Woodrow Wilson school, we also have conversations, meetings where policymakers come to talk with students, faculty, and the general public. But tonight is a different night. We've never done anything like this before, and it is in a way indulging a fantasy I've had to have a series of conversations with the most interesting people I know. And Ed Koch was nice enough to agree to be my first guest, and that pleases me greatly because he is a good friend and a mentor. And when I came to New York in 1982 as head of a new school, we became friends, and he introduced me to the mysteries and the marvels of this great city, and asked me to serve on the various committees, including one you may recall looking at the condition of the homeless shelters. And then when I was chair of the 14th Street Local Development Corporation, I got to see truly how well this city ran under Mayor Koch and his great team, people like Henry Stern, Bob McGuire, Deputy Mayor Larry Townsend, Paul Crotty, Housing Commissioner. It was a great group that he assembled. We became friends and had lunches and dinners on a regular basis, occasions from which I always learned not just about New York, but about the nation and about the world. This is a man of polymathic interests. It's fair to say that what I want to do tonight is start out continuing that conversation. Then I'm going to ask a couple of questions about current events, and not too long into the evening we'll open it up and invite you to become part of the conversation with us. There is a saying that our guest needs no introduction, and then normally after saying that, a long introduction follows. This is a man who needs no introduction, one of the great mayors of New York City, a person who rescued our city from the depths of despair and financial excess and laid the groundwork for its recovery, not just as a place of prosperity, but a place of decency and fairness and justice. I love this quote. You once said, Ed, we have been shaken by troubles that would have destroyed any other city, but we are not any other city. We are the city of New York, and New York in adversity towers above any other city in the world. And I think that's really emblematic of the kind of optimism that he carried with him, of faith in all of us that restored our faith in ourselves and our determination to get back on track and to make the city great once again. Life after Gracie Mansion has been full, columns on politics and world events. The best movie reviewer I know, and I say that looking at Jim Lipton from the Inside the Actor studio back there, so I have to be careful. Appearances in more than 60 films and TV shows, I guess mostly playing himself. Nearly 20 books, from memoirs to mysteries, and a touching conversation with John Cardinal O'Connor, I recall. Ed Koch has remained relevant, a force for principled discourse, unconstrained by the bounds of political correctness and conventional thinking. So, I violated the needs no introduction rule long enough, so let's get started.
My greatest strength throughout my political career has been my willingness to answer a question and not to flinch to say what I think should be said, whether popular or not. It's part of even the way I respond to people. I answer every letter I receive, every email. I send out a commentary to 10,000 people, and you can be on that commentary list. It's free, and you also get two movie reviews if you give me your email before the evening is over, write it out, or give me your card. And I, not every one of them, thank God, sends me a response, but up to 200, sometimes as many as 300, depending on the issue, require responses. And where they raise a substantive issue, I will develop it in my response. Otherwise, it'll be an understandable, thank you very much. So all I can say is, if I had to select two, I don't want to leave my parents out of it, it would be, and it's part of the same, it's DNA and parents, same.
I do recall once getting a thank you note from you for a thank you note I sent you.
Right.
So
I want people to know, you know, most people don't believe that their mail to someone in public life is actually seen by that person. And I want them to know that it is. So that's why I acknowledge it, even with a thank you. So they feel better, yeah, that they're not just simply sending something into a void.
Yeah. Looking back on your public career in the city council, in Congress, as mayor, what are some of your proudest accomplishments, and what were some of your disappointments?
Sure. What I'm most proud of in terms of legacy, because you're always asked, what's your legacy? And the areas that I always cite are the following. One, I gave the people of the city of New York back their morale. I didn't say that. Pat Moynihan said that. Because when I came into office in 78, everybody was moving out. And it was understandable. And I made them feel, once again, proud to be New Yorkers. Two, I balanced the budget, which had never been balanced in 15 years. Three, I created a housing program that built, with city monies, $5.1 billion, 250,000 housing units, 150,000 new ones, new in the sense that we gutted the existing buildings that the city owned that we got in rem because landlords left town and left the buildings to deteriorate. And then I changed the judicial system in a way that it had never been touched before. Most people don't know it, but the mayor appoints the criminal court judges and the family court judges. And I appointed 140 in my 12 years. And when I came in, actually, this is the thing probably that I'm most proud of that most people don't care about, but they should, because it's extremely important. I said, my two predecessors, Lindsay and Wagner, had changed the system so that when they picked someone, they submitted it to a committee, which they had appointed, to simply say, are they able? Are they people who can do the job? Not are they the best? Are they qualified? That's not a merit judicial selection system. So what I did was to create a committee, only half of which were people I appointed. The appellate division judges appointed the other half. And then there were three law school deans who were part of it. who I gave the requirement that they select three candidates for each vacant position. And I would interview the three and pick one of the three, but not my own candidate, one of the three. And even more important than that, because I had no reluctance in criticizing judges, and a lot of people don't think you should. I think you should. They're, I mean, as John Keenan, federal judge, said, I'm no better than anybody else. Of course you should criticize federal judges when you're criticizing other judges as well. I had nothing to do with federal judges, but the criminal court judges, and I did think that they were too soft on crime, and I said so at the time. But I wanted them to know that even if I didn't like them or criticized them, that if the committee, I was pledged, if the committee recommended them for reappointment at the end of their 10-year term, I would automatically, without question, reappoint them. And if the committee said don't, I would not. Now, that rule was violated by Rudy Giuliani, interestingly. I mean, he basically carried it out, but he violated it on three occasions. It was interesting. He wouldn't appoint two judges that the committee recommended for reappointment. What is interesting is those were two terrible judges. But what he should have done was to go to the committee and say, let me tell you why I don't want to reappoint them, and you decide whether or not after that you want me to reappoint them. He didn't do that. He just said, the hell with you. There we go, and put them in. And then with respect to one judge that they said should not be reappointed, he reappointed her. But that executive order, still it's an executive order, remains in effect, and every mayor since my executive order has reissued that executive order.
And disappointments?
Well, yes, I've only confessed one error. and that related to Sydenham. I closed Sydenham Hospital. Every mayor before me for 30 years had said Sydenham must close. It's not capable of delivering medical services. It's in Harlem. And the staff is black. And they don't want to have to be affiliated with, as we wanted them to be, with one of the teaching hospitals. The one that we were going to affiliate them with was New York Presbyterian, Columbia Presbyterian, because they would then lose their chiefs in their own hospital, and they didn't want to do that. And anecdotally, I don't know if it's true or not, but anecdotally, it was said that nobody who had ever had thoracic surgery had survived. So all the experts said, close it. And all the mayors before me said they were going to close it and then flinched when all of the opposition took place. I didn't flinch. And I closed it. And in retrospect, it was an error, even though it was right on the merits. And the reason I say it was an error is I didn't take into consideration the psychological value to the black community. That was a hospital that was opened to accommodate black doctors when other hospitals wouldn't take black doctors on their staffs. So it meant something more than medical treatment, no matter what you said to people as it related to it being inadequate and our willingness to create, as we did, clinics to take its place instead of the hospital, and I ultimately apologize for that. That was a regret, major. Every mayor is asked, who did he see as a role model? And every mayor says LaGuardia. I mean, it's part of the rote. And the truth is, LaGuardia was a very good mayor, and he created a whole new style. But he really wasn't any mayor that I know's real mentor. I don't really believe it, number one, although with great respect for him. For me, a political figure that I cherished throughout my political life was Harry Truman. And I suppose, in an embarrassing way, it would be because he was an ordinary guy. I'm an ordinary guy. And he rose to the occasion. I mean, what he did was extraordinary. And that's why I've always seen him as the person that I would most want to meet. I never met him.
And the least favorite?
Well, I'll pick one that's dead. I think the worst mayor that we had was Impellitteri, of all the mayors of the modern era. I believe that if President Obama were to run today, he'd lose. And I think there's a very good chance he will lose if the unemployment rate continues next year. But he can win. And he can win because he's very lucky in that, with the exception of Mitt Romney, the candidates for president, and it could be someone other than Romney who is the Republican candidate, they're all wackos. And so he's very lucky in that regard. When it comes to Mitt Romney, he's definitely not a wacko. I think he is a very able guy. I think he makes a mistake if he thinks that he doesn't have to explain, as John Kennedy did, the religious factor, because the poll that I saw said that 12% of Republicans will not vote for a Mormon. Now, we may think it's crazy. And listen, every religion has crazy things attached to it. Every. Mine, yours, every, including the Mormons. But you have to explain it. And Kennedy did it very effectively. Romney apparently believes he doesn't have to. I'll bet you that he ultimately will. Now, my own problems, which continue with the president. I thought that he made it very clear that he was going to change the foreign policy of the United States as it related to Israel, the Mideast, in order to make it more acceptable to the Arabs. His first speech was made in Cairo. He's never visited Israel. And many of the statements that he made, and I won't go into all of them, were hostile, and the meeting at the White House with Netanyahu, that was a hostile meeting. The press said that. I am very supportive of the state of Israel, and fortunately, the country is. What is interesting to me, most people don't know it, is amongst Democrats, only 48% support Israel over the Arabs. Amongst Republicans, 85. Democrats don't want to hear this, but it happens to be a fact. And I believe that Obama, in his statements, was conveying some of that feeling. And I said so. I mean, here I'm 86 years old. I'm not looking for a job. I'm going to say it the way I think it. And what is interesting is I saw this possibility of sending him a major message when Anthony Weiner's seat became a special election, and the guy was running on the Democratic ticket, a nice guy from the city council, and then I'd never met Turner. But what I said was, the people in that district, which has a 30% Jewish population, the largest in the country congressionally, and there's only one congressional district in New York that's having an election, only two in the whole country, the country's going to be focused on it. And I said, if the people in that district want to send a message, this is incredible what they can do here. And I got a call immediately from Turner. Turner said, I'd like to come up to see you. I said, come on up. Then I got a call from Weprin, the Democrat. And he said, how can you do this? I said, I want to send a message. He says, I could send the message. I said, David, how could you send the message? Another Democrat from Brooklyn, Queens gets elected? That's a message? Ridiculous. Don't take it personally, I said. So he was pissed. Turner came up, and I said to Turner, listen, I'm going to tell you, if you want me to endorse you, you have to also send a message. My message is to the president, and it's on Israel. He's throwing Israel under the bus. Your message has to be to the Republican national leaders that you're opposed to their trying to privatize Social Security and Medicare and make Medicaid a block grant. You got to be opposed to that. He said, I'm opposed to it. So I said, now go back to your office and write me a letter in which we put this all down and we're going to release it. Your opposition, my opposition. And he came back with the letter. And then we did a really good job there. Now, what was also interesting, he would blame it on other things. Weprin had supported gay marriage, same-sex couples, and the Orthodox there opposed that, the Orthodox Jews, Catholics. But they weren't opposed to his position, because as they told me, because I said, this is terrible on your part, when I spoke to them, I support same-sex marriage, and I'm very proud of the actions I took in New York City, which I won't burden you with, long before anybody else was doing anything to give homosexuals civil rights in the private sector, which they didn't have before I did it by legislation. They said, we don't care about his position. We care about the fact that he's running around, and when he introduces himself, he says to everybody, he's David Weprin, and he's a pious Jew. They said, you cannot be pious and take this position. We vote for the speaker, Shelley Silver. He takes the same position. He doesn't round tell people he's pious. So that's what caused them, and they were a factor, although not a major factor in my judgment. So we sent the message, and I had responded to an invitation by the president having nothing to do with this issue. Oh, and Turner won by 8% margin, incredible win. I had answered the president's invitation to attend an event that he was holding for the UN at the 42nd Street Library. They're very nice, I've been to them before. The last one who invited me was Ronald Reagan. I had a very good time. I thought, well, I'll do it again. So I sent in several weeks before the election took place my response, yes, I'm coming. And the day before the event, I got a call. I got a call, and it was from Richard Daley, the president's chief of staff. He's a very nice man. I know him. He's a lovely man, brother of the former mayor of Chicago. Bill Daley, yeah. But this is William Daley.
Yeah.
That called me. He said, we see you're coming. Would you like to talk with the president for a half hour before the event? Can you come a half hour? So who's going to say no? So I said, oh, I'd love to. So when he came in, it was really quite funny. He's a charming man. I met him once before, a charming man. And he, you know, he'd been prepped, and he came over and he said, oh, you look terrific, and I know you go to the gym every day. Well, I don't. So I said, no, I used to. Then I went in, I had spinal stenosis, and I went into the terrible pain, and I went into the hospital for a quadruple bypass, and by lying in bed for 6 weeks, the spinal stenosis disappeared. And I said it, but in the course of this period, Cardinal O'Connor and I were very good friends, so I held his picture during the day. So if they ever need a miracle for him, I'm his miracle. Daly says, could I borrow the picture? So we had a chat. The president spoke for about 20 minutes, so I didn't interrupt him. And he was he said, I'm nonplussed. I don't understand why Jews are not supportive as they once were. And went into a long statement. And then I said to him, Mr. President, you know, when you said go back to the pre-67 lines, I wouldn't have attacked you. I don't agree with you because they're not defensible. They don't provide the secure borders. But I wouldn't have attacked you if simultaneously you had said to Hamas, you must give up violence and terrorism before Israel has to sit down with you. He said, didn't I say that? I said, no, you didn't. Didn't, actually. I said, but the speech you made this morning at the UN was superb. And
that got you back on the bus?
Well, yeah, and I'll tell you exactly why. The next day, I'm thinking to myself, because his last words were, let's stay in touch. I go home. I say to myself, ultimately, the probability is I'm getting back on this bus. I think it's a disservice to everybody, my cause, the president, everybody, to drag it out and to have the president feel